Good morning and welcome to this week's edition of NCompass Live. I am your host, Krista Burns, here at the Nebraska Library Commission. NCompass Live is the Commission's weekly online event. We're a webinar, we're a webcast, we're an online show. Call us whatever you want. It has very, I guess, the what these things are called is up for debate still. but whatever we are, we're here live online every Wednesday morning at 10 a.m. Central Time. We record the show every week, so if you're unable to join us on Wednesday mornings, that's fine. You can always go to our website, which I will show you at the end of the show, and go to our archives, and we have all of our previous shows listed there. We post the recordings usually to our YouTube channel, so you can watch on there. We also take any presentations that people have or any websites people go to or posted onto either our SlideShare account, Delicious, HostMaster servers, whatever works. We link out to people's pages. So hopefully anything you need for a previous show will be saved and available to you afterwards. We do a mixture of things here, presentations, book reviews, mini training sessions, interviews, basically anything library related, we are happy to have it on our show. That's really our only criteria. Is it library related and can you do it online like this? We have Nebraska Library Commission staff that oftentimes do shows, but we also bring in guest speakers as we have this morning. And well, you can't see it, but across the table from me. we're using our camera for a different purpose this morning for those of you who have watched the show previously, and you'll see that in a little bit. But across the table from me is Kristina Peters, who's here from the Nebraska Department of Education. Your title I've got here is eLearning Specialist and School Library Liaison?
Correct.
Those things? Cool.
Yes.
And she's going to talk to us about this project, which we've actually done stuff with before. I know some other staff of the commission mentioned, I commented, that's a really cool project. I know about that. I'm so glad you're having it up. Oh, cool. So she's going to talk to us about this Nebraska eBooks project. So I'll just hand over to you to take it away.
Sounds good. Well, good morning, everyone. I'm so excited to be here. I am a hand talker, and it feels very weird to not have video right now. So
use your imagination.
If you hear anything movement-wise, that's what I'm doing. So I'm very excited to talk about the Nebraska Books Project. This is the brainchild of my director, Brent Gaswick, at the Department of Education. He's the director of the Network Education and Technology team. And he wanted to encourage students and teachers to start writing and publishing their content. And so that's really how this whole thing started officially 3 years ago. And we've had some good momentum.
So it is pretty new.
Yeah. We've had some good momentum just within the past 2 years since I was voluntold, which is my favorite word, since I was voluntold that I would be taking on the project myself. And I've had the chance to do this exact presentation for several different conferences or professional developments, kind of in-service opportunities at the district level all across the state. And so it's still one of those projects that it's small but mighty. And when we get people to hear about it and get their students or even themselves as teachers or educators involved, then they really start to understand the power that it is. So the Nebraska Books Project, I'm going to go ahead and go right through. The initial idea was content created by Nebraskans for Nebraskans. We had started out by looking at our fourth grade Nebraska history standards. All fourth graders are required to learn about Nebraska history. Not being a Nebraskan, this has been very interesting as an educator.
I'm not either. I'm not originally, I've been here for a long time. I'm originally from New York.
So okay, and I'm originally from Arizona. So yeah, it's a little different. So they teach Nebraska history in fourth and eighth grade, as well as in some high school level classes. But we wanted to look at beyond the typical green Nebraska Adventures textbook, and really starting to dive into more local history. Mm-hmm. And so that's where this whole thing really started. And we know that there are some great stories to be told in Thedford as well as in Omaha. And so, again, that's really where the idea came from. And, of course, we're using a tool called iBooks Author because it's free. And that's our favorite word in the land of libraries. It's our favorite word and in education. So we have created this, and we have this actually sitting on the Nebraska Department of Education website, and you can see the URL right here. So it's just education.ne.gov/nebooks, even if you just do a Google search for any books or Nebraska Department of Education, you'll be able to find it. And then you'll see here, it's a work in progress, which is a lot of websites, but we have the actual overview of the project itself. And we've gone beyond just the school-based partnership to now involve state agencies and nonprofits as well, who have contributed to the project. And again, it's to provide quality instructional materials for the state. And initially, again, I said it was content by Nebraskans for Nebraskans. And we've really expanded beyond that because this has been taken to different conferences outside of Nebraska. And so we have the fun Google Analytics that shows us where traffic is coming from. And so we know that there's a wider audience than just our state. So over here on our left-hand menu, we have the Nebraska Books Overview, a teacher resource center that is designed to help teachers get involved and get started with the project itself. This is not necessarily limited just to teachers. There is a checklist involved, and if you're a checklist kind of person like myself, it's even a good way to kind of start working on the project and get to know what is involved. We also have information on our state agency partners, and then the best part, of course, is the library itself. And this is just a sample of some of the books or the titles that you'll find in our library. They are divided into three different categories, and those are the agency partners. So that ranges anywhere from the Homestead National Monument just south of Beatrice that we've worked with, and they have taken their brochure that you can get whenever you go to the monument and basically digitize that into an iBook and added some interactive features. Native Daughters and the Power of Role Models was done with in conjunction with the Nebraska Department of Education as well as the University of Nebraska in Lincoln to talk about Native American women. And those are some really powerful books to be able to look through. Nebraska and the Civil War was done by the Nebraska State Historical Society. The Corn Board, you know, we have to have some facts about corn in there. So that is in there, as well as a newer book from NET, which is Standing Bear's Footsteps. And so these are some really great titles. We hope to continue adding more of these, obviously, from our agency partners. Currently, I know that Nebraska Game and Parks are working on a couple of books. They are looking at some native animals to Nebraska, and they were working on a snake book that had some really great photos that were a little terrifying to me personally because I can't really do snakes. But I know that kids would be really excited to look at those. And just great nonfiction pieces in general. Here in the middle, we have teacher authors. And so we were able to work with the Omaha Public Schools and the Making Invisible Histories Visible Project. And this is a grant project that has run for the past 4 years, I believe. And they look at specific subcultures or subgroups that are not necessarily represented in a typical history textbook. And so they looked at African American history in Omaha, Native American history in Omaha, and Hispanic American history in Omaha. So I was able to work with them 2 years ago. And they had taken all of their research, and through the grant, they had commissioned local artists and local authors to actually write the content and create some original artwork. And then they brought in a cadre of teachers that put together the iBook itself. So then we have eight different books in this series, the Making Invisible Histories Visible Project. And they really range learning all about African-American culture in Omaha, specifically to Buffalo Soldiers, to the Great Migration from the South up into Omaha. So we're going to get to look at some of these books a little bit later on. And, of course, my favorite part is the student authors. We have had some great success with getting students writing and publishing. So it's pretty cool when some fifth graders, which is our youngest audience right now, or our youngest writers, that say that they have published books.
Yeah.
Now, some of these you will see if you go in here. When you click on the iBook link, it'll take you right into iBooks and you can download it immediately, or some of them have it redirected to go through the iBooks store or through iTunes. Mm-hmm. And that was just their choice when they gave us their book, and that helps them kind of keep track of how many people are coming and visiting their books and whatever. But We are currently adding more and more books to this specific library as far as our student authors. Just this past year, we had Bellevue Public Schools that really worked in their iPad academies all across their grade levels, third through, I think it was eighth grade. And they were using their iPads to create the iBooks. And they were able to develop nearly 300 books.
Wow.
That are not currently in our library because we have no way to house them yet. So that is in process right now. However, you will see some updated books in here as well, just from all across the state, really. So these are some of my first student authors that I had the chance to work with. These were some high-ability learner students from Ralston Public Schools, specifically at Bloomfield Elementary. And I'm a former Ralston employee, so I was excited to go back and work with within that district. It was actually at a different school, but I had such a wonderful time working with them. And it was just a great group of students, very motivated. And when their teacher contacted me about the project, she was like, I want to make this a year-long project. They would meet on Thursdays when they had early release for their teachers to be able and go do professional development. Then they would do any of their high ability learning kind of group work after that time. So they would start that about 1:30 to 3:30. And then they had writing parties afterwards. And wow. So they would stay from 3:30 to 6:30 sometimes.
Wow.
Overall, they put an incredible amount of time and effort and energy into the books themselves. I would say about 100 hours they averaged on the books, doing the research, doing the writing, and then the fun stuff when they got into iBooks Author and adding the interactive pieces, which is why we were kind of drawn again to the iBooks
right.
Author. So they had a chance to come to the state office building downtown Lincoln. This would have been in, February of 2014. And they were able to go in front of the State Board of Education and introduce themselves and say that they were published authors.
Mm-hmm.
And then we opened up our computer lab here at the state office building. And we invited all of our NDE employees to come in, and they were able to kind of walk them through the process and their whole writing process and the bookmaking process itself, and then just kind of have that one-on-one conversation. So these are some NDE employees, as well as the commissioner who's sitting right here and chatting with them, and that pretty much made their year, and
oh,
they
yeah.
were pretty excited about that. That's kind of the big deal. from there, we were able to present at the Nebraska Association of the Gifted conference that is held annually in downtown Omaha. So this was that same group of Ralston students as well as some high ability learner students from Blair Public Schools. And so my students from Ralston were 5th and 6th graders, and then my students from Blair were 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th. And so it really ranged as far as their topics. Mm-hmm. And they were able to present in front of a very crowded room. And they had stations set up like this that they were able to kind of walk through the books and highlight some of their favorite pieces or some research that took them a little bit longer than they had anticipated. And specifically, our Blair students worked with their local historical society, and they were able to go and do a field trip and actually look at primary sources and primary documents, mm-hmm. which we love
yeah.
to hear about. And that being one of our newer standards as far as social studies standards for mm-hmm. teachers to be looking at is really get primary documents in the hands of students and understand mm-hmm. the power of paper, for
right.
one.
Yep. It still is important, yes.
And
you're
power,
not going to find everything online.
No,
yet.
Unfortunately not.
But these books, you're helping. But
that's
yeah.
true. That's true. So learning about the power of history and local perspective. Mm-hmm. And quite honestly, whenever I first started working with these students, we did a workshop at the Educational Service Unit in Omaha. And all of the students were there. They started out the workshop just kind of getting familiar with iBooks Author. And then in the afternoon, they got to play. Mm-hmm. And they got to start their books. And again, you can lose students very easily on that. Not
yeah.
that happens to adults either. But this particular student that's on the screen right now really threw me for a loop. Because in our minds, we'd always anticipated nonfiction books. just purely nonfiction. We're telling, you know, history and historical perspective. And he had a picture of a goat. And he wanted to tell me all about his goat. And the story then became historical fiction. So it was the story of Blair's settlement was told through the perspective of the goat.
Wow, that's creative.
That was traveling up the Missouri, was then sold off, you know, just outside of Omaha, and then brought into Blair, and he talks about the settlement of Blair through the goat's perspective.
Wow.
So, when you give kids the opportunity to write something like this, they never cease to amaze me as far as what they can do.
So the students just pick whatever topic they're interested in that they want to write about?
Yes.
That's nice.
Yes. And so for our Blair students, they chose to kind of focus on Blair-specific things. So Blair history, whether it was historical fiction, whether it was nonfiction. Some did some features around Blair, so the llama farm and some things that you can do. Transportation, that kind of came through there. And the Ralston students did more statewide history, so Plains Indians, Sitting Bull. So they did a little bit broader topic. This was the Nebraska Educational Technology Association, or NETA, the annual conference that happens in early spring. And this was the group of Ralston students, again, that all had the chance to present their individual iBooks and highlight some of the things that they liked. They got really good at speaking that semester because they did multiple presentations.
You're doing it over and over again, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They were looking at their note card, but they all pretty much knew it by heart. And, of course, I'm always a kid at heart, so I had a lot of fun working with the kids themselves. So just this past year, I had the chance to work with Darren Hansen, who is a middle school science teacher out in Lexington. And he contacted me about having his students create iBooks. They have a one-to-one program out there, so all the students have a MacBook. And they were able to go into iBooks Author and create an iBook. And he wanted to take his normal content that he would do. They were focusing on butterflies and the life cycle of butterflies and the butterflies that come through Nebraska for migratory purposes. Mm-hmm. And instead of just him lecturing and them sitting there and taking notes, this was his approach. And they were in charge of all of their research. They utilized Google Apps for Education, and they collaborated on Google Docs. They were able to create all of the content or the text itself. And then when I came in, this would have been in October of 2014, just this past year, we talked about something that's very important when we do this project, copyrights and citations and Creative Commons. And you'll see down at the bottom this photo of these two young ladies that are looking for photos that they can use. And I showed them how they can do an advanced search in Google to find Creative Commons licensed work so that they can use it without infringing copyright. So that actually led to a perfect little mini lesson on copyright for students. And them looking at me going, I can't just copy and paste or drag and drop from Google. No. Let's talk about that.
Talk about some ownership issues.
Yeah. Yeah. So in the process of working with all of these students, it has been a learning process even for me personally. And then some of the folks that I've worked with at the ESUs across the state, as far as what we've learned from the students and the teachers that have done this project, one of those being the citations at the end of a book and how do we cite our sources and how do we attribute the photos or any sort of media that we're using. So that's been a good conversation to have as part of digital citizenship in general. So this is a screenshot of my library that I currently have right now on my iPad. And they kind of range as far as the books that you'll see here. A lot of these up at the top are our student books. So, again, focusing on Blair specifically. Then we have John C. Fremont over here, which is one of the books that was written by a Ralston student, Sitting Bull, Education in the 1800s. That's one of my favorites. And so when we start to show books, I will show you. Their teacher required them to record a video of some sort to include... So some of them dressed up as characters. One student, Noah, that wrote the Fremont book dressed up as John C. Fremont in the book. And Josie, that did the Education in the 1800s, properly donned a dunce cap very well and talked about punishment in the education world in the 1800s. Then we also have the books that were written by the teachers. So the desegregation of Peony Park, the water park out there in Omaha. And then whenever I first start to show iBooks, I love to refer to E.O. Wilson's Life on Earth. This is a series of books all about specifically science. And there are, I believe there are six of these in the series. The reason I show these, they are amazing examples of the potential of iBooks Author. Mm-hmm. And to think that it's a free program, of course, it is Mac-based. But to think that it's a free program that's available to do all of this is pretty incredible. And I've done a lot of workshops on iBooks Author where this is kind of where we start and say, here's where you can go with this. Now let's show you what some students did, and now what can you possibly do with that? So where do you start? Well, first of all, here are some requirements as far as the program itself, iBooks Author. It does require you to run on the Mac platform, so it's the operating system is 10.7.4 or later. I just got a notification about an update for my iBooks Author that anything that they have in there now needs to be updated to the latest version. The reason that they include that is because you can now view any of the books that are created on iBooks Author on phones, on your iPhones specifically.
Reading on their phones, yes. Just on tablets.
So that's good to know. I need to update it myself. Again, the cost is free, but it does require a Mac in order to do that. And the requirements to view this, you would need to do the iBooks, which is a separate actual tool or app. To be able to view it, it sits like just like a bookshelf, and that allows you to see all of the interactivity that are in the books itself, as well as you can just do a PDF, which then takes away any sort of interactive features, and it just allows you to read the content. One nice thing that I will say with recent updates that Apple has put out as far as their operating systems, it used to be where you created the iBook in iBooks Author on either a desktop or a laptop, and you had to view it on an iPad. It took two different devices in order to create them. With the newest operating systems, you can actually create and view on any sort of computer. And we've also found that there is a separate app that now works on iPads called Book Creator, and there is a free version of it. So then teachers, students, anyone can actually create the book on an iPad as well. So this is great for our districts that are one-to-one with iPads and don't necessarily have access to any sort of computer to be able to create those books. They can now just rely on the iPad itself in order to bring that all in. Of course, there's a free version of that Book Creator app, and there's a paid version. Of course, the paid version, you get more benefits out of it. I believe with the free version, you can only make 5 books, and then you'll have to either delete and add more, or pay for that updated version. So I'm going to jump over to our website really fast and to talk through some of the guidelines that we have here. Again, this is actually in the Teacher Resource Center, but even if you're not a teacher, you're welcome to look at the guidelines. So to go into our resources right here, this has developed because of the work that we have done with students and teachers, and it gives you a brief welcome letter as far as those of you that are interested in getting started. Here are some things to consider, as well as recommended steps for success. So there is kind of that checklist. Again, if you are a checklist kind of person, this is where you want to go. So this is for teachers. So we have kind of the checklist on how to get started here. And then if I continue to scroll down, then we have a separate checklist for students, and they're actually divided up based on the level of students. So we have elementary, middle school, and high school. The expectations for each of these continue to get a little bit more difficult as far as citing sources and attribution. So it's citations and attribution become a little more strict as we get up into the higher level of students, just because that's the same expectations we have as far as standards, our English language arts standards. So they, again, have some of the same things as far as their checklist, and I just kind of want to run through some of this because when people even express interest to begin with, they say, I don't even know where to start. So That is the first step right there. And it's just narrowing down your topic. I stress this a lot with students and teachers in just being a topic that you really, really want to work on, because it's not a process that can be a week long. It's a much more intensive process. And so it's something that you want to make sure that you really want to write about and to put out there for everyone. Then we talk about researching and being able to keep all of your notes in some sort of word processing. We have a lot of students that are using Google Apps for Education, so they're using Google Docs. There is the built-in research tool in Google Docs, so you can actually do research without leaving the document itself, and it'll also help you with the citations, which is very nice. And then we have our multimedia resources, and that's where I refer people to our Creative Commons, the search.creativecommons.org, and they can go in and start to look for images and videos and anything like that. We do have a YouTube permission letter. Some do not see that this is necessarily required. It is just something that we practice as far as being good digital citizens. There is a way of embedding a YouTube video in the book itself. And so it's as simple as leaving a comment underneath the YouTube video saying, hey, I'd really like to link to this or embed this in my iBook. And you can even give them the link of the ebook project itself so that they can kind of see it's a valid project.
Would that also be a point where you would also explain the licensing that YouTube does provide for the creators of videos?
Yes.
They can sometimes, before you even have to ask, say, this is available for someone to reuse, or this is rights restricted.
Yes.
Similar to the Creative Commons issues with just photos.
Yeah, absolutely. And even whenever I was looking back up here, as far as the multimedia resources, we've also had questions come up about music.
That can be sticky.
Yes, it can be. So I, again, refer folks to Creative Commons just because they have Creative Commons licensed music.
There's so much stuff you can find that's already out there.
Yeah, even based on genre. So I really want something upbeat here on this video, but yet I want something more melancholy here or whatever. So that's very nice. Then the process kind of goes with pre-writing. Everything is done. Like, we haven't even touched iBooks Author yet. We've done the research. We've looked at different images and videos that might help support the research that we found. And now I'm typing it up just like I would a paper. Then we revise, we fact check, we edit. And that can be peer editing or peer revising as well as the teacher that is involved with this. And then you get to get into the fun stuff, and that is storyboarding and designing the actual iBook. And this is a process that is often skipped, and I highly, highly stress taking the time to doing it, because iBooks Author is pretty linear in the sense that when you start a chapter and then you decide later on that you want to add another chapter, you can't really move things around. So it's best to be able to sketch it out, decide the order of your book or the table of contents or whatever it's going to look like. And it's just kind of a fun little project. So if you like to work on post-it notes and stickies and you want to put it up on the wall and you say, this is what chapter one is going to be, this is what section one is going to look like, or however that looks for you, but really trying to think through the actual design of the iBook. Then you get to open up iBooks Author. And there are some things here as well. So choosing the template carefully, because it can't be changed after it started. Using the chapters and sections very carefully or thoughtfully, because that determines the table of contents. Again, it's harder to move things around. And as far as including who it's authored by on the cover page, just like you would have on anything, title and author. So then we preview the final copy in iBooks to make sure it looks correct, and we ask for some more feedback, either through peers or the teacher themselves, and then they send me their copies, and then we add that to the library. So that's the official process itself. You'll see down at the bottom, it also says determine the Creative Commons license. We've had a lot of folks start to give us their Creative Commons license to be added, because we do not proof, or we do not edit or anything like that ourselves at the Department of Education. We just don't have the capacity to do that.
Yeah.
And so we have a disclaimer that says not everything has been reviewed for any sort of copyright infringement, So we want to make sure that they're aware of the Creative Commons process, and that kind of helps alleviate any sort of issues that might potentially happen.
Now, you had said earlier that all the iBooks author and everything, this is all Mac specific, but I noticed it says that it can come, the books can come out as a PDF as well.
Yes.
So wouldn't that mean that someone who's on something that's not Mac would as least be able to view some sort of version
yes,
of it?
Yes, exactly. Okay. Yes. You can view it non-Mac based. You will just, it's a flat PDF.
Okay.
So any of the interactive features that they've added, whether that's video or different galleries of photos that you can kind of go through, and you lose any of that. You can still access the text and like the overall content.
Right.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
So there's the content is there for people.
Yeah.
Because then you had also mentioned something about how it was, you just got to notice there's been an update to it. And I was looking for that, actually. I don't know, I've got a separate laptop here. And what actually is interesting, and this may be something, I don't know if this is need to update or whatever, but with the update in July, they're now supporting EPUB 3. Which, yeah, that's the new thing. So that means the iBook can, according to this blurb I got here, exported to the EPUB 3 format, which is also all that media, all that interactive stuff would be able to come out. Now, I know this is a brand new thing. You might not know the answer.
Yeah.
Would that mean the students would have to like do just, you know, still create it in iBooks author, but then just, rather than just exporting it as that, export it also as the EPUB 3 for the interactive access to, on other devices, not Mac.
Okay. I'm assuming that's how it's going to work because it would still be in the actual software itself and then kind of how we do the export of the PDF.
Right.
Just as an option, so I'm assuming that that's how that would be as well.
It's brand new, so
yeah, that's good to know, though.
Yeah. So, I mean, when you mentioned an update, I was like, ooh, well, let's find out and get some info about that connected, because you know, I put links. I've got links to EPUB author or my iBooks author and stuff, and so I said, let's look it up, and that's what I found out. So someone did ask about it. Can't be used on other platforms? Well, yes, it can.
Yes.
Right now, it's PDFs, but probably
right now.
In the future, this EPUB that just came out like July was the update, so. Still needs
and we're getting back into the swing of the school year, so I haven't really worked on this project all summer. So,
and it may be something that it just says you just export it in the new format. The previous books, you just need to be re-exported in the EPUB, and not nothing new needs to be created or anything on them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a couple of teachers I could reach out to and ask them to do that. That'd be great.
So it is very Mac-centric as far as creating the stuff, so if getting kids and students to use it, but once it's done, it will now be, anybody can.
As I mentioned before, here is the YouTube permission slip. Again, this is just kind of out of courtesy, contacting the owner of the video and just saying what the purposes of including it in the iBook would be and a link to the project itself. And lastly, we have the project release form, and this is our liability form that I'm required to through the Department of Education. We really want to recognize the student authors with their first name and last name, of course. And so in order to do that, we have to have permission from the parents that it is okay in order to do that. And so that is in English and in Spanish on here as well. So that is kind of the guidelines that we have for teachers. And this is also broken out into the YouTube permission letter as well as the release forms down here. We have had a couple of people that have expressed interest in developing some video tutorials or step-by-step directions. However, quite honestly, I refer people to YouTube most often just so that they can get a sense of things and why reinvent the wheel when there are hundreds of videos already out there for iBooks author, and you can become a YouTube mechanic, as I call that. Our state agency partners, we have a few that are listed on here, and these are just folks that have worked with us over the past couple years getting this project started. We wanted to recognize them. And so here we go into the eBook library. And here are our student authors. And you will see we offer most of them in the iBook version as well as the PDF so that you can view it if you are not on a Mac specifically. And some of these, we have the 75-word summary of what the book entails. Some of these other ones, they were just sent to me and I don't have anything further, but obviously it's worth exploring those. Regardless of having that actual summary to get started.
Some of the titles are pretty obvious. So.
Yeah, it does help.
Not a problem.
We had some students from Omaha North High Magnet School that in their production class, they created some iBooks. And so that's what some of these ones without the summaries are. Famous Nebraskans, Choose Your Own Adventure. Do you remember the Choose Your Own Adventure books?
Oh, yes. I love those. Yes.
So they took on that that genre and created an iBook out of that, which I thought was pretty cool. Throwing a Football 101. I mean, that's very important for our high schoolers.
In Nebraska,
so,
yes.
And Nebraska, yes. That's right here. And Nebraska. Okay. So I'm going to flip back over and just make sure. Oh, yes. Okay. Did want to go back to this really fast before I flip over to looking at some of the books. This past spring, we were able to join together with our Apple representative here in the eastern part of the state, as well as the Nebraska Book Festival, and we had a student and teacher showcase. And this was really just to give the folks that had contributed to the Nebraska Books Project one other place to showcase their books. And so since we had so many students at Bellevue that contributed to the project, they had their own showcase back in March. And each student had their own table and an iPad, and they walked people through the books and had the opportunity to share the whole process with them. We even had the local news, the local NBC affiliate, come out and record them, and that was pretty cool. Yeah,
that'd be very exciting.
Yeah, their district superintendent was there, as well as some district level administration, and just a lot of fun to see the pride in the work, of course, from some of these third graders all the way through eighth grade. And then this was at the Nebraska Book Festival at the end of April. Throughout the day, there are some workshops and some Nebraska authors that come and read from their books. And so we had our students, this was at UNO's Community Engagement Center. We had students that came in and had their iPads and their iBooks with them that could talk to any of the participants in the book festival. And so these are the students from Lexington that actually drove in for the day, which was really cool.
Nice.
And you'll notice some of these students are ELL students, are English language learners, and they are first generation Americans, and also the first time that they were able to ever go to a university campus.
Wow.
So that was a pretty big deal, not just for being published authors at that point, but also for getting the opportunity to go to the University of Nebraska Omaha's campus. So we had some great attendance as far as the participants that were at the festival that day, as well as community members that just casually walked in throughout the day, and they had the chance to see some of the work that these students did. So this was one of our students from Bellevue who actually came in by himself, who's so wonderful, a little third grader who came in and really wanted to show off his book, brought his mom and his little brother.
He's showing that to, actually, that's Rod Wagner there, the director of the Library Commission.
I
bet Rod didn't know he's going to be on the show today.
I know. I forgot to tell him. Hey, Rod, you're on here. And then they were able to, again, show this off to any people that came in. And then they did their formal presentations to one another that evening, where we celebrated each of them, again, through the help of our partner in Apple. And these were the students from Lexington. So they had a great experience with it. And Darren Hansen's already planning to do this again this next year with his 7th and 8th grade students. So
nice.
That speaks volumes to me about the experience and the potential of what they want to do for this next year.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm going to switch over now and showcase some of our books. All right.
Okay. Should be able to just minimize and see if the camera view is there.
Aha.
There we go.
There we
Looks
go.
Good. Yep.
Sounds good. Okay.
Do you need to adjust the camera, or do you want me to zoom
in? I think we're good right now.
Okay.
I'll hold it up, too.
Okay,
so I am running this on, it's an antique at this point. This lovely thing is an iPad, too, if you're familiar with that. But iBooks is the actual app that I will use to look through the books itself.
And more comfortably, I can zoom in to get closer.
Okay, sure.
So if you don't want to need to hold it.
All right. Then I'll put it back down here. Perfect. Yeah, that looks great. Thank you. So it just looks like a bookshelf, and I can go in and open up each one of them with a simple touch. So this is The Great Migration. This is one of our teacher authors out of Omaha Public Schools. and it flips through just like a regular book. There's some information about the project itself, as well as how you can actually use the book.
Right.
We do find that some people need directions on how to use the iBook, which is totally fine. And then it gets into the actual content itself. I'm going to flip this one. You'll notice that this is, there we go. That was a portrait.
Makes more sense. Yeah. That way.
Yeah. Sorry, we're going to zoom it out just a minute. There we go. Okay. So this is a portrait only. It was created. You have a couple of options when you go into iBooks Author, choosing your template, and that you could do a portrait only so that it looks more book style or magazine mm-hmm. style. Or you can do the landscape where it looks like you turn the pages. So this is written for a third grade level because that's when they really start to focus on local history. So this would be Omaha history specifically. And one of the nice features about iBooks Author is you'll see some of these words are bolded, and so I can actually click on it and that'll take me to the glossary right here, and this was a definition that teacher then added to the book to be able to explain what the word was. So they nice. Focus on specific vocabulary words throughout the book in order to kind of highlight those words. And then of course at the end of the page they have a kind of think check your understanding down here, a reflection question that the teacher can ask or that the students can stop and think through themselves, depending on how it's really used in the classroom. So this is all original artwork by a local artist.
That's cool.
Yeah. They worked with the Great Plains Black History Museum in order to get access to some primary documents and primary resources specifically. So they have some original photographs, original newspaper clippings, and then even like this little bubble right here is a photograph analysis. So it's really starting to look at what's happening in this picture right here and asking some of those more critical thinking questions of the students that would be looking at this. So this is one of the widgets that runs in iBooks Author. It's called a gallery. So instead of just putting one single static image, I can actually make that pop open and expand. And then you'll notice that I have some thumbnails down here at the bottom. So that means there's more than one that I can actually go through at a time. And there's a caption at the bottom that then allows them to kind of customize what this picture is about. Same thing right here. Railroad industry. They had some photos from UP. The original name tag.
Nice.
It includes charts and graphs in here as well, talking about different populations so they can understand that. And then here is one of the features that we really enjoy as far as educational context. There's actually a built-in quiz that you can do within iBooks.
Oh, nice.
So we're checking for understanding before we would be ready to move on. So I can check here, check my answer, and it'll actually self-correct right there. And then I get the green arrow, green check mark, and then I can go on to the next question. So these were only two questions right here. But that allows me to kind of break things up and make sure that my students or even I am tracking along with what I'm reading. This is another widget right here. This is a popover. So it allows you to kind of customize either a specific photo or in this case it's a map that allows you to then have that little bubble that pops up. Do you all remember VH1's pop-up
video?
Oh,
yes.
Yes. Loved pop-up video.
VH1 is all classic now.
I know.
Which
so
is
this
depressing.
Is a pop-up feature. Whoops. I'm going to go back to that. Allows you to go through. There we go. Mm-hmm. So talking about some of the specific people that they're talking about in the book itself and where they're coming from. So in Alabama, two different locations in Alabama as well as Mississippi. So that's one of the widgets there. Beautiful artwork. I'm always impressed every time I go back in here and the artwork that's in here. I was trying to get to a page. Oh, here's one activity. Whoops. Again, for classroom purposes, this was looking at the article itself as well as the image and looking at the analysis of the article. So talking about what really happened, what are three important things that they talk about in here. And then there's an activity towards the end. I'm going to scroll through here. Take a stand. There we go. They talk about designing your own protest sign and things like that. And so what would that look like? And so they give them an actual activity for them to then extend the book or the use of the book in the classroom. So I really like that. And, of course, there's information about each of them.
And the artist, too, that they got.
Yeah. So that's pretty cool. So that is one of the teacher-created books. I'm going to go into that Education in the 1800s book. So this was written by a sixth grader at the time, and this is my dunce cap video that I love to show. And you'll see that this is the landscape view, so I've been able to turn it, and then it goes full screen. So it looks more of book style when you slide between pages. Mm-hmm. That's your preference. So the original image of a dunce cap, if you're not familiar with that, here's Josie talking about it.
It's so humiliating to be scolded in front of the whole entire class and all my friends. I was only taking a quick peek out the window because it's just a wonderful day outside. And it's hard not to because my desk was right by the window.
So they have the chance to really kind of understand just what they were writing about and then add that to the book itself. So we've had some really great books added to the library just throughout the past 2 years. This one specifically is The Spider, and this was written with that app called Book Creator. So it's a little bit different format, but you can still view it on in your iBooks. And so it functions more like a book that it looks like it's turning the page. And this was a third grader that created everything that you see on here. They hand drew everything with on the iPad. And so then they were telling me the story as they were reading through it. This was intended for more of a kindergarten or first grade audience because it didn't require them to have to read. And he just wanted to be able to write a book that didn't require them to read. So I loved his intention with that. And then the last thing was a fact. The tropical jumping spider is the only known vegetarian out of 40,000 spider species.
Wow.
I had no idea.
I have not had known that, no.
Learned something new today. So that kind of gives you an idea as far as what the possibilities are with some of these books. And I'm going to take some questions. Do we have any questions?
Sure. Yeah, that's very – I'm just amazed how creative it is with the kids putting together these ideas and stories that they come up with. But I guess it does really show how easy to use and how useful this software is, the iBook author program. Does anybody have any questions? If you have any questions, type them in your questions section every GoToWebinar interface. Or if you have a microphone, let me know and we can unmute you and you can ask your question that way. Nothing came in while you were talking. Except one comment about not being able to use that in other platforms. But right now you sort of can, as we said, with the PDF.
Exactly.
And hopefully coming once they get the EPUB update involved in the program.
Yep.
It'll be available more. So on the website itself, you don't have to have an iPad to actually get to. You just go to your webpage, show it there.
Yep.
And then that will get
yep.
you access just to all the books there.
Yes.
In the PDF format. Woo! So not all the fun interactive things, but like you said, the content, which is
absolutely
just as important.
Yeah. And we have had a lot of our school districts that are moving towards Chromebooks.
Mm-hmm.
And that adds a whole new layer of complexity just because it's not Mac and it's not Windows based.
It's something else now.
So for those that are interested in that, we're looking into options.
Mm-hmm. I was trying to look myself as to see, is there something compatible to iBooks Author on other platforms? And I found a few iffy sort of things, but not really. I guess Apple really jumped in to do this. And getting kids to write is one thing.
Right.
But this is more talking about people asking, well, what about all the interactive stuff that they can do? That's really
exactly
the fun things that we want to have them be able to do.
Right.
Not finding a lot. If you know of anything, let us know.
Yeah.
the URL, oh, never mind. Yeah, someone just asked, what's the URL to see these iBook project presentations? The one you have right there on the page there.
Yes.
At the top there is the specific one to the student author's library. But the main URL, just up to the NeBooks part, is will be included in the links at the end of the show. I've already added it to our Delicious account there.
Perfect.
You can get and see what all the kids have done. And the student ones. I mean, everything is on there. You just go to the specific part of the library. I've added links that are to this, to the iBooks author webpage itself, if anyone wants to look at it just on your own.
Great.
That Making Invisible History is Visible.
Yes.
They have a website out there.
Yes, they do.
And a Google for Education, of course.
Yeah.
For all the Google apps that a lot of them use. So it doesn't look like anybody else has any questions. Anybody have anything?
Anyone?
Anyone?
Bueller?
We covered everything. I think this is really, this is actually Richard Miller, our library. Development director here has recommended having you on the show to talk about this, and I was like, and actually had a whole list of different things that you guys do over there, and I just jumped on this one, of course. I was like, oh, this looks like a lot of fun. I was glad to have you on. The question about what formats it available on. You can view the PDF on any. On any device. You do not have to have an iPad to view that. You just need to have something Mac, Apple, to do the interactive version. So the PDF is available to anyone. And coming soon, at some undetermined future date, they just updated the iBook Author with EPUB capabilities. Mm-hmm. So the books will be able to be exported in that format, which then is available on any device with all the interactive fun stuff that was created. So... this is what you have now, and we'll hopefully get something coming soon.
Yeah.
For more.
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah. All right. We're almost at the top of the hour again at 11, so that's great. I think nobody has any urgent questions. Kristina's information is right.
Yeah.
Contact info is on the webpage there.
There.
So if you do have any questions, want to know more about it, get involved in the program, you can reach out to her. And learn more about it. So, thank you very much. This is great. Yeah. We'll just wrap up the show. Mouse over here, and I can switch over. And actually, let me get back to here. You can do me a favor. Type in NCompass Live. NCompass. The first one there. Yeah. There we go. If you're looking for our show, when you type in NCompass Live on Google, we are the first one. So that will wrap it up for this week's show. It has been recorded and will be available here on our website. As I said, right down here is all of our archive sessions. So you can go there and see everything we've previously done. Going back to January 2009 is when we started. Everything is there. Here's last week's, the recording on YouTube, presentations put on SlideShare in this case, and links on our Delicious account. What I'll do for this one is I've got the recording about the links. I'll just link to your Google this year, so if you can have access to this, just email me the link afterwards, and we'll have that. And you can watch a recording for this afterwards. I hope you join us next week when our topic is, and something you actually kind of mentioned, your digital footprint, managing your online identity. Denise Harders, who is co-director of our Central Plains Library System here in Nebraska, is going to do a session on things that you do online and how they are out there and what you need to know about tracking them and keeping up with what you're doing and keeping things private if you want to. and basically, this is a session for helping others know how to take care of theirs. We've done a session before about your own brand, your own online identity. This would be more of the, you're going to have people coming into your library who are using these services and don't really know what they should and shouldn't be doing and how to handle all that. Denise is going to help us with that next
week. Very timely after what happened with the new Husker announcer yesterday.
Yes, I know. It is. Wow. We're right on top of things.
You
here.
Are.
We know it. that was very interesting. Anyhow, So sign up for that and any of our future shows you have here. We've got all of our September dates booked and up, and we'll have more coming up. Also, if you are a Facebook user, we all are on Facebook, and Compass Live has a Facebook page, so do go ahead and like our page over there. You get notifications here every Wednesday morning. I put a reminder up, let you know you can log in on the fly. When our recordings are available, I post them here. So if you are big on Facebook, do go ahead and like us over there to keep get notifications regularly about what we're doing. Other than that, that wraps it up for today. Thank you very much, Kristina.
Thank you.
This was great. Thank you, everyone, for attending. And we will see you next time on NCompass Live. Bye-bye.